Okay, we're going to continue a talk or a message on, you know, how to live in a perverse and wicked generation. This is part three, the last 2 weeks. I'm going to try my hardest to slow down. My wife came, she came to me last week. She goes, I don't know what you were taking last Sunday morning, but you were talking really fast. And I go, well, I was. And I went back and listened. I go, sounded fine to me. I could keep up with myself. So, you know, I think sometimes I get so excited about God's word that I just want us to get this, you know. And I was trying to preface a lot of stuff and recap what we talked about 2 weeks ago. You know, the Church of Philippi, what the Church of Philippi was going through, the Church of Philippi, how it was, you know, struggling and how it had a lot of struggles and a lot of similar struggles that we're facing today and even more so struggles. And I thought it was a good parallel to use the Church of Philippi on the things that we see going on in our world today. So I hope that you began to see, you know, the things that the Church of Philippi was going through and what, you know, Paul was trying to tell them to do, you know, keep your faith. So in Philippians, we're in Philippians chapter 2, where I have 5 through 18 on your bulletin, but we're really going to start in verse 12 and finish the rest of this passage here. And then I've got just a slew of passages of Scripture that we're going to share to kind of drive this point home, because now what I want to get to is the three points that I've been talking about the leading up to this last 2 weeks. Who are we, where are we, and what are we supposed to do? How are we supposed to live in this perverse and wicked generation that we see coming our way right now? You know, we see all these lies and deception and things going on in the world. You know, how are we to live? So where are we, who are we, and you know, how are we to live in a perverse and wicked generation? And so I've kind of laid out over the last weeks, you know, what a perverse and wicked generation it is. I've held nothing back about, you know, seeing riots in the streets and seeing all the lawlessness and talking about lawless leaders and just you know, just trying to expose the lie. And I believe that that we need to do that. I think we need to expose the lie as much as we expose the truth. And if that means that people get mad and leave, it's not my intention to get people to be mad and leave, but it is to expose the truth and then to be light in darkness. In fact, that's how our scriptures is telling us. We're in verse 12, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12, it says we are to be light bearers. We are to illuminate. We're supposed to be the illumination of Christ. We're supposed to be illumination of God and His Son in a dark and perverse, wicked generation. And so we are to lift Him up. We're supposed to do everything we can to lead people into the kingdom of God. And of course, you know, we went through a number of weeks of talking about spiritual blindness, those who will never be able to see and those who will be made to see. And so we spent, what, 5 or 6 weeks just talking about spiritual blindness and why we see the things going on in the world that we see today. And then, you know, I just exposed, you know, and just talking about the things that are going on in the world that we need, I think, prepare ourselves for. And so I'm going to try to slow myself down just a little, okay? And I want to make sure that I get all these points in here today, because I think this is really, really important. But we're supposed to be light bearers. We're supposed to, and that's 1 John is really talking about being the light. We need to be light bearers in this world of darkness. And there's a lot of darkness and wickedness and deception going on in this world. They want to try President Trump under insurrection, and they want to try him under sedition, when many of the politicians that are accusing him of those things have done just about as bad or worse things than what he did. You get in their face. You don't let them relax. Our vice president, VP, this is truth, okay? This is not about politics. This is truth, okay? And if you don't believe me, go look this up. But our vice president, Kamala Harris, was on interview saying that, talking about the riots, saying that the riots are not going to stop. They should not stop. In fact, don't expect them to stop. Not now, not until election, not even after the election. In fact, she said they shouldn't stop. So who's inciting insurrection? Who is inciting sedition and being seditious? So the very people that accuse one person of being or of doing the very things themselves, they ought to look themselves in the mirror. Now, I know that in many churches, that pastors that would preach these kinds of things, you'd probably lose half your congregation. Maybe I will. But this is truth. This isn't something I'm making up. This is something that it can be verified. And so we see lawlessness. We've seen buildings burned down. We've seen businesses destroyed. And we see even the day of the election, riots were going on in Portland. And where is the condemnation on any of that stuff? Yet it goes on, right? It's going on and on and on. And then they just justify it and the media just glasses over it. I mean, if you remember, there was one media report where buildings were burning in the background and the reporters sitting there, well, it's a mostly peaceful peaceful protest. Well, things are burning down behind him. How is that peaceful? 24 or 25,000 troops deployed to our capital because they thought there was going to be a massive insurrection. Anybody that supported Donald Trump, again, I'm not making any endorsement or anything. I'm just saying this is what is. They think that they're the ones that are seditious, and those are the ones that are going to be the uprising. And yet none of it happened. Not one capital that I know of was taken over during the 20th, right? The inauguration. And so we live in this wicked and perverse generation, and our leaders better wake up or face the consequences of God's judgment. And unfortunately, some of that judgment flows. It's like filling a bowl full of water. Eventually, when it gets to the top, it gets to the rim, what happens to the water? It starts to full overflow, right? So we're going to feel some of that pressure, okay? But don't be dismayed, don't be in despair, because the church of Philippi was going under many of the very similar things that we are going to experience or are experiencing right now. And we have a promise, and that is Jesus Christ. Our home, he isn't here on this earth. It's in heaven. And so in this darkness, and in all these things that we see going on in our politics and in our government and in the world today, you as a believer, do not be dismayed. Do not fear. For God knows exactly what he's doing, and he will use evil, even evil, to push forward his agenda, if I can call it an agenda, but his will, okay? His will. Nothing's going to thwart God's will. Not man. He's God. And so let's look at verse 12. Let's pray. Lord, give us some insight here again on your word, and I pray, God, that you'll help us to understand and apply these things to our life that we learn. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so in verse 12, Philippians 2:12, it says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with what? Fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both and to works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and what? Perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain and labored in vain. Yes, I am being poured out as a drink offering." Remember, he's in prison. "On the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you. For the same reason, you also be glad and rejoice with me." Under all the persecution that we've looked at, he says, be glad, rejoice, be happy, be joyful. How can you do that? Because they know their faith is in God and in Jesus Christ. So, understanding where we are in a perverse and wicked generation. In the past few weeks, I've laid this groundwork for the church of Philippi. I showed the conditions. They were under attack outwardly. They were under attack inwardly with false doctrines. They showed that they were a poor church, that they were giving out of their abundance. Even what they didn't have, they were giving. Yet they gave out of their heart. And they had disunity within the ranks, and they were telling Euodia and Syntyche, you know, to work it out. And in spite of all that, of what they had going on, they stayed faithful, and they were being encouraged to stay faithful to God and to Jesus Christ, as Paul has instructed them to do. This church was a good example for us to take notice of what happens in a perverse and wicked generation when the church becomes under persecution, religious persecution. We would do ourselves, I think, a great favor to understand this church and to live like this, and I hope that we can understand that whatever comes into the church, however the church is infiltrated, no matter what it is, we need to stay true to the faith, no matter what. No matter how hard it gets, speak the truth. So the generation they lived in really isn't much different than the generation we're living in today. Of course, there are some variations. You know, the Roman Empire, you know, that was, I told you about the battles and stuff, you know, about Antony and Octavian and Brutus and stuff in that battle and the fall of the Roman Republic into the Roman Empire, the massive, mighty Roman Empire. And so you've got all that information. But they were in the midst of a corrupt and perverse generation, and they saw lawless leaders as well, as we see lawless leaders. And the result of that was, and especially when you have lawless leaders and you have lawlessness going on in your nation, you begin to see a decline in morality. You see a decline just about in every walk of life. You begin to see this moral decline. The Bible is clear about the perversity of man, the corruption of the heart, when we do things our way. When left unchecked, it becomes perverse and wicked in every way. Jesus called his generation in his time a perverse and wicked generation in Matthew 17:17, when Jesus said, then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation. This is the world that we live in. We live in the midst of corruption. We live in the midst of leaders that pervert the truth and morality. And it becomes so faithless that God eventually has to judge that. Eventually, his wrath has to come down on that. Proverbs describes the world and its perversities in Proverbs 2:10-15. Listen, it gives two views here. So in Proverbs 2:10-15, it says, when wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you. Understanding will keep you to deliver you from what? The way of evil, from the man who speaks perverse things, from those who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness, who rejoice in doing evil and delight in the perversity of the wicked, whose ways are crooked and are devious in their paths. Now, this word of crooked is comes from the word of scoliosis. It means bent or crooked or, you know, not straight. It's a crooked and perverse generation. So we live in this world that eventually will turn away from God. There will be no moral absolutes, and they will pervert mankind and their ways. When you walk with God, though, there is wisdom, as we just saw, and peace and joy and contentment, meaning you begin to understand the meaning of life. For apart from God, you can do nothing. Apart from God, we become perverse and wicked and evil. Proverbs 21:8 says this, the way of a guilty man is perverse, but as for the pure, his work is right. So both the Old and New Testament both spoke of this perverse generation, the wicked and the upright, the righteous. But Isaiah understood this also. He addressed this in his day about this perverse and wicked generation in his time. In Isaiah 59:7-8, it says, their feet run to evil, and they make haste and shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity, wasting the destruction on their paths. The way of peace they have not known, and there is no justice in their ways. They have made themselves crooked paths. Whoever takes that way shall not know peace. Now, when I read this, again, this comes to my mind, the shedding of innocent blood. It really angers me that our president would sign an executive order to send money overseas to kill babies. It's wrong, and it needs to be called out. Not only do we want to abort our babies here, our vice president says everybody is entitled to great health care. What about the unborn? Are they not entitled to good health care either? They become perverse. They become wicked. Their ways are crooked. Their thoughts cannot understand or comprehend what morality even is. They've corrupted it so bad, they don't even know right from wrong anymore. It's a perverse and wicked generation. So you see, there really isn't anything different about then and about now. The heart wanders away from the Lord. It becomes corrupt. And in the corruption, there is lying, there is cheating, there is deception, there is hatefulness, there is anger, there is bitterness, there is selfishness, and all sorts of perverse and wicked things that go on in the heart of man. And man sits there and writes laws to justify their sin. It's crooked, it's perverse, it's wicked, and it's lost in its darkness. And we're supposed to be the illuminary in this kind of perverse and wicked generation. It is no accident that you live here right now in this time. God has a purpose for your life. We are here for a reason in this time. God has a purpose for all things, for all generations, for all people that have lived, that are living, that will live. We need to be faithful to God, though. And we need to continue in His ways. God is calling on you. He's calling on us to light up this world with His Word in this perverse and wicked generation. However, they're not going to like it, because what does light do? Light exposes the darkness. It exposes darkness. We are to point out lies, and we are to uphold His Word, His truth. We are not to despair. We're not to cower down. We're not to shut up, be quiet, shut up, or speak up. We're supposed to stand up, speak up, stand out, and live our lives in the light of Jesus Christ in a perverse and wicked generation. That is what we're called to do. As Jesus was getting ready to depart from this world, to suffer at the hand of man, the sinfulness, the sinful ways of man, getting ready to die, He was subjected to a perverse and wicked generation. But He left others behind, His disciples, to carry out the ministry. And in John chapter 16, He holds them, or He told them that He is leaving, but they are to stay behind and continue in the work and be strong. For in John 16, 1 through 3, it says, "These things I have spoken to you, that you should not be made to stumble. Stand firm in your faith, that they will put you out of the synagogues." Now, think about this. They will put you out of the synagogues. They will put you out of the church. Okay? They will put you out. I don't know how it's going to all come down. They will put you out of the church. They're going to put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think that he offers God service. And these things they will do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. He's preparing His disciples as He prepared us. But Jesus is preparing His disciple to stay behind, to be the light, the illuminary in the dark and perverse, wicked and wicked generation. Jesus told them that they will be persecuted, they will be put out of the synagogues, they will feel like they will feel the full brunt of the pressure of lawless leaders. But He encourages them by saying in John 16, 33, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." If you are in Christ, you have overcome the world. There's nothing the world can do. They can take your life, but they cannot take your soul. We are not to panic. We're not to be dismayed. For everything that is before us, and we are here for a reason, we're to be the luminary into this dark world. And as we know, these things have been told to us from Genesis all the way to the book of Revelation. As Jesus prayed for them in chapter 17 of John, Jesus was praying for them. You know what? He wasn't praying that God would take them out of the world. He was praying that he would get them through it. He was praying that he would get them through it. And this is what it says in John 17, 15 through 19. It says, I do not pray that you should take them out of this world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. Who is the evil one? Satan himself. That they would keep them from the evil one. Keep your mind focused. That they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified in the truth. He is sending us into a dark, wicked, and perverse generation to illuminate the light, to lead at least even one more person into his kingdom. We're here for a reason. We're here for a purpose. We're here at this time for a specific task, for a specific, I want to say purpose again. I already said that. But we're here for a reason. And God wants us to carry that out. That's what we're here for. So understanding, okay, who we are, okay? We are children of God. We are children of the light, not the children of darkness. Your eyes have been opened. So we are here in this crooked and perverse generation. If we are where we're supposed to be then what are we supposed to do? You might come to some quick conclusions, but I want to just kind of think about this just for a minute and expand on this to give a perspective of our lives in Christ so that as we live as we're supposed to. We talked about in Sunday school being the foundation, having a solid foundation in Matthew 7. If we are the children of God, then we are to be the light of God. The Bible says that the world is of the devil, and we are not to boast be of the devil. We are supposed to be in Christ. So 1 John 3:8 says, he who sins is what? Of the devil. He who sins is of the devil. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. We are the light. John 5:19 says, we know that we are of God, and the whole world lives under the sway of the wicked one. The world is of the devil. You are of the light. Be the light, be the luminary in a time of darkness. Don't be influenced by the darkness, be influenced by the light. Be the light, don't be the darkness. Don't be of the evil one. So there is light and there is darkness. The world is of the wicked one, the devil. But those who belong to Christ are the light of Christ, the light of God, and we're supposed to illuminate the light of God in everything that we do so we can lead people into his kingdom. And we can't do that if we're tearing each other down. It's hard to love somebody you don't like, huh? It's, you know, I won't ask for a show of hands, but I bet every hand could go up and go, I bet you could think of somebody you just don't like, right? But you know what? What are we supposed to do? Love? We're supposed to care, have compassion. That doesn't mean we don't speak the truth, you know? Some people are going to get mad at you because you speak the truth. I've had people mad at me. I've been attacked recently, as I told you. It's because I'm speaking truth. And they don't agree. Well, you know, look. Go look for yourself. You know, here's the word of God. Here's the truth. There's no truth. This is the only truth. This is the truth will set you free. Jesus can, you know, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody come to the Father except through me. This is the truth. And if you don't want to believe in this truth, whose truth are you going to believe in? Because if this is the only truth, you want to believe in man's truth, it's going to lead you astray. Man's truth is deceptive. It's wicked. It's not good. It's evil. They're going to go their own way. And eventually, you know what? We're going to be led astray. And we need to wake this world up because these people and some of our politicians, not all of them, but some of our politicians are leading people right off the dang cliff. I probably shouldn't say dang, right? But they're leading them off a cliff, and I care. I care so much that I'm willing to speak the truth, and I'm willing to expose the lie, and I think God's going to do a whole lot more with a handful of totally dedicated people than he can with a whole bunch of lukewarm ones. And I think God You know, that's what the Bible says. The Bible says what? That narrows the path to heaven. But wide is the path of destruction. We got to expose this. And so Satan is darkness, Jesus is the light. And in Jesus' word, okay, here in John 8:12, he says, "And Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but the light of life. You are the light of the world." Jesus was talking to the Pharisees and scribes in chapter 8. And they were questioning him. And he said, and of course, they always questioned Jesus. They didn't want to believe he was who he said he was. I've given you all that. We've talked about all that. But they didn't believe that Jesus was the Christ. And they tried to trick him with the adulterous woman and questioned him about who he was. And Jesus finally said what? Okay, they brought the adulterous woman to Jesus. "Look, we caught her in adultery, Jesus. What do we do now? We need a stoner. That our law says a stoner." Jesus scoops down, starts writing in the dirt, right? What was he writing? Who knows? What was Jesus' response? "You who is without sin, cast the first stone." Slowly they start walking away. Jesus then, as he looks up, everybody's gone, looks at the adulterous woman and says, "Where are your accusers at?" You know why? The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Okay, everybody, who's everybody? That's you and me. None of us are righteous. None of us can carry it out. Not a pastor. We're all sinners saved by grace through his son, Jesus Christ. That's it. I can't save you. Jesus is the one who saves. So Jesus was pointing to the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's no different today. Jesus is telling our leaders the same thing. Jesus and God is saying, this is a wicked and perverse generation. They are not of God because they speak lies, they speak deception, and they are not of the truth. And if they're speaking lies and deception and they're not of the truth, Jesus says, they are of the devil. They are of the evil one. Don't follow them if they're speaking lies and deception. Those who follow them are deceived in the lies, and they follow blindly into their deception. To them, the truth is the lie. That's the biggest lie. To say that this is the lie. We want to pick and choose here what we like and don't like, but we got to take all of it or none of it. And so they lead him right off the cliff. It would be to call right, wrong, wrong, right. To call Satan God and God Satan, which some have done. And by the way, that will happen in the tribulation. We don't have time to get into Daniel chapter 9 or some of the Revelation studies right now. We've talked about all that. But this is when the abomination of desolation, this is when he sets himself up in the third temple when it's rebuilt, and props himself up in the temple and calls himself God, and people will follow him blindly and will be deceived. So don't be surprised when you see the lies and deception and wickedness in this world, for they cannot tell the truth because there is no truth in them. There is no truth in them. They belong to the father of lies, but you and us, we're of God, who is light. You are of the Father. Live in that light. We are the children of God. And if you believe in God, you are his son. And if you are his son, then you have the truth that lives in you. In 1 John 1:4 and 1:8, we see this. John 1:4 and 5, it says, "In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." John 1:12 goes on and says, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to be the children of God, to those who believe in his name." If you know Jesus Christ, if you confessed with your mouth, if you believe it in your heart, if you repented of your sins, then you are a child of God, and nobody can take that away. And we're supposed to illuminate that light, and we should be able to know when we see darkness and wickedness and lies. Be of the light. Don't be of the darkness. If you have received him, then you are a child of God, and God lives in you. You begin to understand it. You know it, and you walk in it. You have been made to see him. Remember that spiritual blindness thing we did? those who have been made to see. You live in the light of Christ in the midst of evil. You're not to be of the world. You're in the world, but don't be of the world. Be of the light. In John 3:10 it says, but this children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness, listen to this, anyone who does not practice the righteousness of God, nor the one who does love of his brother, guess what? If you don't follow that, you're not of the light. So when we see lies, lack of love, injustice, sin, you can know that those people are the father of lies. They belong to the world. They belong to the devil himself, and there is no love in them. But those that love and care live in the obedience of God and are the father of eternal life. Satan is in the world. He is of the world. He is the, you know, well, he's the roaring lion, right? Prowls around seeing who he can destroy. Prince of the air. But you have the truth. And in 1 John 3:1 it says, how great is the Father, or how great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. So when the world doesn't know you and you are persecuted because of your faith and belief, it's because they don't know the Father. They don't know him. They are of the world. So how are we to live then in this time? Understanding how we're supposed to live. We're supposed to live in a perverse and wicked generation, and it can definitely be difficult. And sometimes, guess what? It's not even pleasurable. Who wants to suffer? I don't. But yet, we live in this world where we know there's going to be suffering. The world is broken down. It's frightful, sinful, it's rebellious, and it, in all its ways, there's so much injustice, harm, sufferings, and starvation and death. The list could just go on. It's all around us, and our leaders don't even seem to really care. They see it and do nothing about it. They promise everything and practically deliver on nothing. So how are we to live in a time then? And by the way, you want to know the truth? I'm going to get myself in trouble. That whole thing in Georgia, the election, the runoffs, what did they promise everybody to get elected?
$2,000.
Okay, what do they promise now? 14 to some people. Not everyone. They're changing the rules. That was a lie and a deception from the very beginning. To promise you something to get elected and then change it. That is of the devil. Now, that's not political. That's the truth. That's what happened. That's what happened. And I'm not going to be afraid or ashamed to call it out. And there's only me and Emmett and Dora sitting here. Well, it'll just be us three. Then we'll just have a big old, we'll have a three-way potluck, you know, if I can say that. Forget it, I got to move on. I get myself in trouble. Whew, it's close. Okay, Pilate questioned Jesus, okay, when he stood before him. Okay, 1 John 18:37 says, "You are the king. Are you the king then?" He said. Said Pilate, and Jesus answered, "You are right to say that I am the king. In fact, for this reason I was born. For this I come into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth, listen. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." They couldn't see it. Pilate responded, "What is truth? What is truth? The truth is this. Jesus is the truth. God's word is truth. This is the truth. What is truth? Right here. You hold it in your hand. The truth. You hold the truth in your hand." Pilate says, "What is truth?" Have you ever asked that? What is truth? We were talking right before we were praying. We always pray before we come in here. And we were talking about truth. Where do you get truth? Where do you get it anymore? You can't listen to the media. You can't listen to anybody. Where is truth? What is truth? Where do you find the truth? I tell you what. In the world, there is no truth. Except we got this right here. This is truth. You want the truth? Turn to the Scriptures. This is truth. God is truth. His Word is truth. And it says, if you know the truth sets you free. His truth leads you into righteousness. His truth leads you into salvation. His truth is truth. It is the Word of God. Man, almost done here, okay? Hang in there just a second, okay? In John 19, 10 and 11, it says, do you refuse to speak to me? Pilate said. Don't you realize that I have the power that I have the power either to free you or to crucify you? You know what Jesus' response is, don't you? You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is the guilty one of grace. He goes, you have no power over me. Guess what? The world has no power over you except what God has already has ordained in your life. There's no power. The authority is only granted by God. Even Satan has to get permission from God. Even Satan is powerless against God. Okay? God planned it from the very beginning. And we can see this in the book of Revelation, Revelation 8 or 11, 16 through 18. It says, for the 24 elders who were seated on the throne, I can just see this, and we talked about the 24 elders before, and I don't have time to get into all that, and their thrones before God, fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time is coming for judging and judging the dead, for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your saints, and those who reverence your name, both great or small and great, and for destroying those who destroy the earth. God's judgment is coming. And in Revelation 19, they're going to, you know, all the saints are going to ring out. Remember, I said, that's the first time in Revelation you see hallelujah. And they're ringing out the hallelujah. Why? Because Jesus is victorious. He's coming down. He's going to set his foot on the Mount of Zion right there. And he's going to enter into the east gate. Remember, the earth's going to quake. The one side's going to go north and south. He's going to go right through that east gate. And he's going to reign. And he's going to be victorious. So don't give up in a perverse and wicked generation. We have salvation. His son. We're talking about the ultimate reign of Christ in the end. We know we live in a church age. We know a rapture is going to happen. We know we got the 7-year tribulation. We know we got the 1,000-year millennial reign. And one final battle will coincide. It'll be so many. They're just unleashed. And then the end will be. But we have the promise now. We live in this world. And we're supposed to illuminate this world. In Revelation 11:15, it says the seventh angel sounded the trumpet. And there were loud voices from heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. That's the promise. That's the message. That's what we're trying to give people. Hope, light, love, eternal salvation with God. But the world will reject it. And so in Matthew 25, those who reject it says, in verse 46, then these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So let's end with our Philippians verse 2, 5 through 8 says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the form who being the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as man, he humbled himself. We humble ourselves. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. What a mighty Savior we have. Amen? Live in humility. Live as a shining star. Fear God. Don't fear man. Understand that we are led by him, but the unsaved world is not. Live in his promise. Understand that anything in your life, everything that happens in your life is temporary. And there is an ultimate healing coming. But get through this life and don't ever give up. Be the illumination of God.